Have we really advanced the ball? I don't know if anyone else wakes up and does that in the morning, invigorating. I also wanted to see if one of Charlene's robots would come and serve as my avatar so I could sit in the audience myself. That's so epic. And you might think, sitting
for you getting to speak to the most passionate people in healthcare would be on my bucket list, especially when I conceived of OWHIC not far from here 8 years ago with many of you in the room. And you would be mistaken. Instead, I have been ushered in by a blues band, and I incarnate a song from the Blues Brothers with your help. John Belushi and Dan Aykroyd, fame filmed right here in Chicago 4 years ago. And in that movie, there was a musician named Cab Calloway. And he enlisted a call and response with the audience. And by the way, I have not attempted anything like this since my bar mitzvah when I was a foot shorter and 10 octaves higher. So I'm not sure how this is gonna go. But I'm gonna say something and you are going to say it back to me. All right. Hidey, 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 ho. We're doing that one more time. Your coffee is kicking in. If not, I will be your elixir of caffeine. Hi-de, hi-de, ho. Okay, so not only do I have a bucket list item complete, I have just proven that if healthcare leaders can sing together, that anything is possible. So this is not by coincidence, right? The Blues, they started their journey with an impact orientation. They had a mission. Does anyone know what their mission was? Care to shout it out? Mission from God. Well, how about our mission? Right, so thankfully, we have Oliver Wyman consultants, and we had two of them pour through all of the mission statements, at least all of the incumbents in many years, right? You can imagine from Beautiful Minds or Hidden Figures, words kind of popping up, and they landed on the page, and this is what it looks like. Is that with 200 plus organizations, you use the same 40 words. Okay, which either speaks to a profound lack of creativity in healthcare, or perhaps a shared purpose, right? And I was actually pleased many triple or quadruple A on here, although affordability might be lower than I would have anticipated. So why does it always feel, with the same 40 words and awfully similar missions, like we are on opposite sides of the negotiating table, right? Providers and providers battling over base rates and retail pharmacies. By the way, if you're wondering my allegiance to that beautiful picture behind me, Jason Veritek of the Red Sox, stiff-arming Alex Rodriguez of the Yankees, even though I've lived in Chicago for many years, and I think I told my wife I'm in Nashville for the week, so I wouldn't have to go. am I being recorded? I am. That's a problem. I am originally from Boston. I have a son of Boston. But we are bound by a shared purpose, right? We are bound by a triple aim, and thanks to Horace, he was reminding us that it's a quadruple aim, ladies and gentlemen. It's about our people too. And it's hard to argue with these pillars, right? They provide a compass. They tell us direction to go, right? But if you were Magellan and you hopped on a boat and you started sailing west, you would hope you'd hit land, but you wouldn't exactly know where and when and how. So a compass, but that compass is a fuzzy yardstick. It does not provide a view of excellence or of, right? And it's my belief that we need both to be able to propel ourselves forward, right? So I'd like to think about the question that sits behind me and spend 15 seconds writing down some initial thoughts. What does great impact in healthcare And not just great impact, what does great impact look like that is measurable? Because I think if we polled the room, we would get 100 different answers. So spend 10 seconds jotting down some thoughts. And then at the end of this conversation, check back. At the end of today, check back on that. When you go to your organization, check back on that. I am hopefully going in the next 20 minutes to give you a view of what we believe that your can be and how we change our trajectory, and it's going to be incumbent upon all of you to lead us there. Resting on your laurels, right? Your change sponge is. And it has been a decade of activity, right? New payment models, new access points, new therapies, right? And there are tangible ways to measure that swarm of activity, right? And many of those numbers sit behind me, from over 30 million lives in accountable care organizations to over $11,000 flowing through the innovation economy that are funding many of the organizations in the room today, to genomics, the cost of profiling coming crashing down in the last 10 years, and you have your own figures. You have your own figures. If we were with ourselves, right, these should be the big dials. We're not moving the triple aim dials enough. So let's take a look at those, right? Let's start with experience, right? And as someone on the stage here a few years ago, Steve Helmsley told us, right, NPS is the new EPS. Okay, well, over the past few decades, we have erected a hassle map to end all hassle maps, right? It's a Byzantine labyrinth, a fragmented set of touch points. So behold the fruits of our labor, healthcare sectors, this cousin, service providers. Yikes. And it doesn't mean there aren't leading examples. There are in healthcare, but this page, there is tremendous opportunity, and many from the outside see this as a right place to invest because of it. And how about those other at least two pillars? Progress, right? I know you understand this intuitively, but I still find it to look at. In 1970, the United States was actually on very comparable footing in terms of life expectancy and cost per capita. So flash forward to today, and you know the story. And I'm going to go back and forth a couple times so you can see it. We somehow turned off the map over there, and we're in our own orbit, right? We're in our own orbit, or perhaps black hole. Life expectancy has now declined in three consecutive years for the first time in a century, and costs are spiraling. And you know that, but the human impact figures are staggering. And we should put these in the pit of our stomach as we round, right? Does anyone know what premiums were 18 years ago for a family of four? They were $5,000 a year. And I bet many people in the room know where they are today for that same family of four. They are nearly $20,000 a year. We have quadrupled premium. So any show of hands, have we quadrupled the value of healthcare? No show of hands. Okay. And do we know what's happened with deductibles over the last 8 years, 10 years? Deductibles have grown 8 times faster than wages. Right, so we have created a de facto consumer market, but we have not equipped consumers to handle that burden of choice and cost, right? And the leading cause of personal debt and bankruptcy in this country, it's not housing, it's healthcare, right? And there are plenty of excuses for why we're an outlier, right? We have fragmented distribution, and we have state-based regulation, and we don't have price controls. You want to know the other reason we're an outlier? The U.S. spends our dollars differently than those other countries. We spend $1 on healthcare for every $1 social services and programs that support health, and all those other countries spend $2 on all those other programs to every $1 on healthcare. We asked this group, many of you in the room, last year, your confidence view of progress and right, and we looked at small dials and big dials, and you are actually confident in some really important things. You said in 10 years' time, more than 50% of visits will happen virtually for primary care, unleashing access across the market, and that mental health is embedded in the heart of what we do from a delivery standpoint, and you believe the consumers will own their own data and that it will be portable, and that clinical decisions are rooted in genetics. But you are not confident in the big dials. This is the leading group of healthcare executives in the country. Not confident in the big dials. You want to know what you told us when we asked you the question, when would costs decline as a percent of GDP? 30% of you said never, or later than 2040. And then another organization come in from the outside, I don't know, say Amazon. A story I read about a year ago, you guys saw it, it was actually pretty jarring. Amazon has been stocking physicians by the thousand, and they're ready to deploy them in your markets at a moment's notice, pulling them off, and unfortunately, they pulled the dock off, and they had a little bit of an accident and crushed one with a forklift, so they're still working on their quality control. I'm sure they'll get it, and thanks to The Onion for that source of inspiration. I should probably put that qualifier in case people actually thought that happened. So yes, it's daunting, right? Sometimes it feels like we're pushing a ball up a hill like Sisyphus and the dam under our feet. So onward, that view of progress and what is possible. Well, first we have to define, right? We have to define the possible. And each of your organizations individually has an ambition, right? Collectively, some of our individual parts, okay? And why is that? Well, surely part of the answer is that we trap innovation in silos in healthcare, right? We push innovation to the side and it's very hard to scale, right? Look no further than the care model innovators who have focused on the highest risk and cost populations. And when we asked for 5 years, what did he do? He decided not to put wings on boats, he built a plane, right? He built a plane, and those purpose-built models have done amazing things, right? A tremendous total cost of care takeout. But when you add up all of them, starting with CareMore to Iora to ChenMed and Oak Street, et cetera, do you know how many lives they're managing in aggregate over the last 20 years, how far we've gotten? About 500,000 lives. Wait for the innovators to scale a clinic at a time and 2,000 lives at a time. We need you. We need scale multipliers, right? So it has to start with the incumbents who have to be honest with themselves and say, homogenous ways of approaching population health won't cut it. You just start segmenting your clinical models and your operating models, your engagement models in mass and not in pilot form. You need ecosystems. You need to actually look like retailers to extend your eyes, ears, and reach, right? And we need to think digital with chronic disease management, not digital last. But you wanna know what? If we were to take the best of what we have across the country and spread it, and everyone were to get it, started to wonder how far would we get? We'll take the care model example. If we just pulled the care model lever as hard as we could, right, we'd be able to immediately take 5%, at least 5% of costs out of the system in total. And I'm thinking to myself, well, how is that? Right, how is that? I actually want pyramid math taking us further, and that's because the laws of healthcare work in funny ways. It's in a lot of different places. So we started to dissect that. We took $3.5 trillion and we broke it into their component parts. We looked at every funding segment. We looked at every site of service and we started to map it to operators. found is that, yes, it's an innovation and diffusion gap problem, but the big issue is we have and fast enough. And those levers sit in three categories. They sit in three categories and professional services reside. Right? The second actually sits in these massive adjacencies. And last but certainly not least, pharmacy spend. Right? And the third area is that we aren't defining the boundaries of health right. The $3 trillion, it's... And when we started to look at the opportunity is massive. That core system transformation, the big adjacencies, and that redefined boundaries, 15%, not of the $2 trillion of the total stack, we can take 5 to 10% can be coming from these big adjacencies and another 10% plus from redefining the boundaries. We have a $1 trillion opportunity. And it used to call this value rotation. This isn't value rotation. This is $1 trillion that we can take out in the spirit of affordability. So let's talk through these. What levers can we be pulling? The care model one we talked about. That's about much greater diffusion of what we know works. For the others, though, we're bumping into a ceiling. There are levers in the core system transformation. Right, site of care or site of service, overhead costs, price normalization, and utilization management. And we're hitting a ceiling because of our assumptions for how we need to be pulling those levers. Ambulatory, urgent, et cetera. Who's running an ambulatory strategy in this room, right? That. But when we get to the end there, we still presume that the care has to occur within certain boundaries. And we heard a little bit yesterday in terms of how far you could push that if it were digital first, and I think I would totally subscribe to that, but there are a few others, right? We have this new front door. Well, a front door presumes that you have to go mindful of whether someone has to go through the system and start to lever AI and other checking and other ways of making sure someone needs that care to begin with. We are barely scratching the surface of what's going to happen from a retail and the thumb of the local clinician. And we have that presumption. And we bundle diagnosis, care planning, and together. Did anyone see the study that Walmart shared back in April that was jarring? So Walmart sent its employee, gave people the opportunity who had a cancer diagnosis to go to Mayo to get a second opinion. And what Mayo found is that 10% of those individuals didn't, and that over 50%, they moved to a different treatment plan. So we, clinician, when diagnostics absolutely be moving to centers of excellence or treatment planning, and when we put the pen in the hand of the physician, of course, the next logical step is if you're a surgeon, you're going to have surgery, which pushes us over to the utilization management. With UM, it's about approvals, right? Other may I. We're not looking at variance. We're not looking at appropriateness. Should that surgery have really happened, right? So you have orientation there. And by the way, you need to go through an approval or a prior auth process. Make it reasonable. My son has recently, we learned, he has epilepsy. And we ran out of a prescription. And we're trying to titrate the dose. And we ran out 2 days before we could fill it. And we tried to get the drug, and we explained the circumstances. We were forced to pay for it out of pocket, a $100 drug. Thankfully, my wife is a pediatric neurologist. And $100 is not going to make or break us, but for many families, it will be. So stop. Offer no, right? It's overhead costs. Heard a little bit from Sean yesterday, the power of automation, but we need to rethink the processes, right? We have processes that should be public utility, but like provider credentialing, things like that. We have processes that simply exist because of the inane commercial construct, right? Claims, and authorizations, and rebates. And we have processes that absolutely automation. So you can start to imagine each of these levers, and I won't speak to price, just go pick up Marty McCary's book. Marty should have been here. The price we pay. We certainly have predatory pricing. It's not just about predatory pricing, though. Transparency, we actually need comparability. So transparency will help, but we need the ability to have an economic that's comparable to one and the other. How about those adjacencies? I'm going to skip over the cottage and go right to drug. Does anyone know that this is the first year where specialty spend, traditional medical stack, that pyramid, those pyramid economics, the FREDs, the Honda, hypertensive, obese, non-compliant, diabetic adult, of our sins in healthcare and our opportunity in Health Market 2.0 that we talked about. How does that compare to pharmacy? I'm just going to let the numbers just sit there for a second. So this came almost knocked me off my chair. The top 0.5% of pharmacies, and this is not the drug benefit or the medical benefit, this is all pharmacy spend, 0.5% driving 35% of costs, 2.5% driving 65% of costs, 7% pharmacy spend. Right, today we use pharmacy in the service of medical. Well, tomorrow, pharmacy is actually going to be pure measures that it's need to be part of how you think about your future pyramid model. Structure of demand. Extending into the daily life. So what do we mean by that? That is where and when the interventions occur. We're not waiting for them. We're finding opportunities to intervene at the right moment. And then we have to contextualize that. So the next part of it is the what of that interaction has to be different. It can't be about when someone has symptoms. We have to start to find the ability to harness information, make that much more personalized in the individual's context. It's about the framework of demand itself. How do we enable our customers to enter into healthcare? The way they enter into healthcare today is with product or a narrow network, but who's looking at the product and saying product architecture, deductible plans with a service, primary care looks like Sutter's coverage on the back end, who's working on subscriptions, who's making relevant for different. Through the right product architecture way of framing demand to begin with. And I'm not asking you to put down your sword and shield of growth and say, demographic shifts. We hurdle through a tough economic stretch and our labor markets shift over a 10-year period, and we have to find ways to start to be more sustainable. These are the levers that matter. These are the dials that matter. That's fine. Measure your top line. Measure your growth. Measure your bottom line. It's still healthy to have a financial view of. But who's measuring in managed by those highly intensive care models? Or who's measuring overhead costs But cost to serve, what is your average cost to serve per customer? That's a sensible way of doing it that many other industries do. Right, so we need, I would implore you to start to think about not just metrics of success, standing out there with skeptical eyes, right? And I don't know which of these characters you identify with, and you have your agendas, but as Sam said, are we working on the things that are urgent, that just feel urgent, or are we working on the things that are important, right? And driving an agenda along these lines with this level of impact will reset our line, will put us back in that map with other countries. And it's not just about supply or demand, it's both. And the only way we're getting there, if you actually broke the one organization owns all of them, we need force multipliers, right? We need a taxonomy that allows for the innovators to come into the market. We need ecosystems, local communities that get reimagined, and we need a lot of courage. So onward, and heidi, heidi, heidi.